Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Dickinson Theater, home of the Dickinson Theater Organ Society. We are very pleased to have you with us here tonight as we celebrate in the middle of our 50th season, but tonight is a very special night because tonight is our 300th concert over our 50 years. How about that? I want to give a special welcome to all of our season ticket holders. Thank you for your support, for staying with us, and for being a part of the Dickinson family. And welcome to those of you who are here for the very first time tonight. We hope you enjoy what you see and hear, and you'll come back and you'll bring people with you. A special shout out as well to all those who are listening and watching us on our streamed performances on YouTube. We have Dickinson fans from all over the world, and we're so blessed and pleased to have you join us as well. But I can tell you, there's nothing like being here in this auditorium during one of our performances when you can feel the magic of the majestic and mighty Kimball Theater pipe organ. If you're new to us, or if you'd like to join our mailing list, please, at intermission, come up and complete one of these forms here on the stage. You can put it right here in the blue bucket. They'll be out at intermission as well. Thanks to all of you who've responded so generously to our annual fundraising campaign. Thanks for helping us continue to keep these concerts going and bringing world-renowned artists right here to Wilmington, Delaware. And if you're saying to yourself, "Ah, shucks, I missed it," well, guess what? It's not too late. You can still give to our campaign. We'd love to have you as a contributor. Before we get started, I just want to remind you that during intermission, our music shop will be open, and you can browse through the various CDs, DVDs, and Dickinson merchandise that's available for purchase. And now for our artist. Over the last 10 years, David Gray has built his profile, become one of the most active and critically acclaimed theater organists performing on the international circuit today. This is his third appearance at Dickinson. And I remember the last time he was here, I stood in the back during rehearsal, and I watched him run down the aisle and leap up here onto the stage. And I said, "Holy cow, first of all, are you okay? Did you hurt yourself?" But if he has that much energy, imagine what we're gonna see in the concert. Well, I can tell you that he's still full of energy. And wait till you see what you're gonna see tonight, you'll agree. David was born in Glasgow, Scotland, first showed his interest in music at the age of 4. He taught himself how to play piano by ear, and his first lessons followed a year later. His first experience playing a theater pipe organ was in 2004, and a year later, 2005, he won the ATOS Young Theater Organist Competition in Los Angeles, and that was performed in 5 ATOS conventions. In 2007, he received the Cinema Organ Society's Ian Sutherland Award and has performed widely in the UK, as well as completing 3 concert tours in Australia and New Zealand. Last year alone, he traveled to the USA 5 times to play and has performed in some of the most prestigious venues in the UK, the USA, Holland, and Australia. David recently announced his intentions to retire from theater organ and return to playing the concert piano. So tonight, right here at Dickinson, we will celebrate David's final theater organ concert, and we are so pleased to have him here with us. So back for his third and what will now be his final theater organ concert appearance, please welcome David Gray.
Thank you. How's that for a roar, huh? Usually I wait until a little bit in the program before cranking an organ like this up, but I thought, screw it, this is the end, I'm done. Throw the balls to the wall, gas to the floor, and go with it. I have started under no uncertain terms. Well, good evening and welcome from me to the David Gray Memorial Concert. I announced that I intend to move away for the foreseeable future from playing theatre organ concerts, but crikey, after that, I guess I'm going to have to give up, huh? It's a long story I'll hopefully be able to get into later, but it is a real honour to be here to play not only this amazing theatre organ, one of the greatest in existence, but for the 50th anniversary season for DTOS and the 300th concert here, which is a wonderful legacy they have, because Dickinson as a venue really has set the standard over the years. I started with their 42nd Street by Harry Warren from, what's the name of that show? This instrument doesn't only roar, it also plays very softly, very sweetly. There are so many beautiful voices on it. But I won't bother with any of those just now. Here's another fun novelty. This is by Zez Confrey. It's not Kitten on the Keys. It is called, wait, what the heck is it called? Nickel in the Slot. As I said before, that's a good piece to put at the start of the programme, because if I'm not concentrating yet, or a little bit nervous, it's written to kind of sound like a million wrong notes, so you guys don't know how many I really played or not. this concert is special on many levels, just let alone the venue and the fact that it is the end of all of my tours and also the 50th anniversary for D2OS. But there are many friends in the audience here. I can't believe how many grippies are here that I met. I'm not sure who traveled the furthest. I've seen friends from Atlanta, from Boston, apparently from some California. But there's a friend here who I'm going to embarrass, who actually I met 10 years ago at the Royal Academy of Music in London. I'm first and foremost a pianist, and this person, her name is Anna. I met her in London, and then I told her 5 years back or something, I'm playing this theater organ concert in a place called New York, Delaware. She's like, get out. She's like, no way, that's 10 minutes from my house, and I'll be there. And so of two of the three times I've played here, Anna has happened to be in town. And she is here again. And she's here with her family and a boyfriend. And the first time I played here, I improvised my way through Send in the Clowns for Bob Dilworth. Well, Anna loved this piece, and now she's always like, oh, play the clowns. So of course, I can't resist playing for Anna. Send in the clowns, but first I need to embarrass you some further. Can you please stand up? Let's everyone give Anna a round of applause. Where is she? Excuse me, I've been trying not to lose my voice for a few days, got one of these bugs off an airplane. Right now we're listening to 16-foot David Gray. But I'm going to do another tribute just now. This is for John Nelson. He has supported me at many concerts. He's a great friend and a wonderful person, and he was the manager and friend of George Wright for many years. So I always do some George Wright tributes. Well, John's latest request, I played it once this year already. That was George Wright's arrangement of Richard Rogers' Slaughter on 10th Avenue. Good, I didn't hear too much disapproval. That's fine. It's one of these pieces so overplayed at one point, I'm scared to do it. This is wonderful music by Richard Rogers, of course, from the ballet, and this is George Wright's take on it, recorded on the Vaughan organ in the Hi-Fi series in the 50s. Don't think there's much more to say, except I'm always a little nervous at the start. It's just five very loud notes. It's a terrible place to hit my wrong note, so if I can get through that, get through the rest of the piece. But here we go.
Thank you.
Also in the audience tonight are my family from Atlantic City. There are many wonderful friends I have there on the team or associated with the restoration of the Midmerlosh and the Kimball organs and boardwalk hall. And if any of you are familiar with those instruments, you know I don't have to say much. For those of you who are not familiar with them, it's highly worth a look. And it's not just because these are two of the greatest organs in the world. In fact, I consider them to be more than organs, especially the Midmerlosh. I think it is the pinnacle of the creation of acoustic sound. And it's one of the most moving sounds on the planet. And the team have done miracles there. And I have the highest honor of being asked to record both instruments on a CD for the Historic Organ Restoration Committee there. That's going to go on this year, and I'm incredibly excited about it. And as I said, the progress on these instruments is just wonderful. But for that program, I'm doing a mixed bag of music, and of course, the Midmerlosh is more of a classical instrument, albeit orchestral with examples of all types of pipework in it. Nonetheless, I did have to break my rule. My rule used to be no cocktail piano or popular piano music, and no classical organ literature. That was what I thought kept me sane until I realized there was no point in trying to pretend I have any sanity. And one work I chose to play on the Midmer is the great Opus 5 suite of Maurice Durufli, one of the great works of French literature. And there's a particularly wonderful second movement called the Sicilienne. It actually goes pretty well on pipe work like this. It has the most magical effects, and it's a very sweet, simple, innocent little tune, and uses lots of different flutes, crisscrossing back and forwards, color ranks, strings, and there's a part in the middle where you're required to play the tune with your feet. And as a theater organist, I had to work on my right ankle to get this thing to go, to actually use my right foot on the organ for once. Of course, theater organists usually only know how to swing their left foot back and forward for Oompa Loompa. But there's a part that requires the Vox Humana solo on the pedal. And that's all very well. French organ Vox Humana sounds something like this. We can improve on that here. We have these great tibias and voxes I cannot resist, and I'm sure Monsieur Drufli would forgive me. So here we go with the Sicilienne. And I think we have a camera that will pan in on the feet. So I will excuse the shabby looking shoes in advance. Someone complained about them at the last concert. Well, you know, these shoes I have played every concert and every practice session in for the last 5 years. So kind of like Glenn Gould running around with his little crummy old piano chair. Here's my red ruby slippers, whatever you call them. Of course, I've had a little glass coffin made for them once I retire. Here we go.
Thank you.
back into safe toe-tapping territory. One of the biggest influences on my playing, and someone who became a real musical hero for me when I first started the theater organ, was Jim Riggs from California. And I was just in California, actually. I played in the Bay Area and also in this new studio set up by the film composer Nate Barr, called Bandrika Studios, with the Fox Studio Wurlitzer. It's the most wonderful place, and Nate Barr has done amazing things and bringing the theater organ forward on a new platform. But Jim actually honored me by making the journey down from the Bay Area to hear my concert. And it was so inspiring to have him there. And so I always play some of his numbers, his arrangements for him. And this time I played a piece he recorded in Oakland called Reaching for Someone and Not Finding Anyone There. And he said he's heard me play a lot of his things, but that was probably the most authentic and closest to his style that I'd done. So I thought I'd share that one tonight. So here is Jim's arrangement of Reaching for Someone and Not Finding Anyone There. Okay, time to see if I'm really concentrating. I'll improvise my way through something I don't have an arrangement for, but that's fun because it's theater organ. I did it the other week with this tune. I don't remember how I played it, but it is a wonderful piece by Frank Churchill. You don't hear it so often anymore. It's from the first cartoon movie ever made by Disney, Snow White, and it's Someday My Prince Will Come. I don't know what key to start in. Can someone shout a key for me? C. All right. Just as well, I'm still working on those black notes.
Thank you.
I thought against the corny wind chimes there, I'll use them for something else. They're wonderful, they're just a little predictable and loud. But up next is a medley of some of my favourite music to play. This is definitely firm in the middle of Theatroyan territory. It's from the pen of Cole Porter, and it's from one of his greatest shows, Anything Goes. It's amazing how many of his best hits went into that one production. We have things like, obviously, Anything Goes, more very suggestive titles, All Through the Night, You're the Top, Blow, Gabriel, Blow, I Get a Kick Out of You. And, of course, then we'll go back to the repeats of Anything Goes. This is a very well put together score. Most people, myself included, usually play a kind of medley of Cole Porter tunies, but actually he wove this material together very skillfully and kind of done a quasi transcription of all this stuff. So some arranging, some improvising, and a lot of transcribed material and stuff I wrote myself that I thought was kind of in the style. So without further ado, here is our medley, Cole Porter's Anything Goes. Thank you. to take a slight departure from the programme list to honour someone very important here today. This organ is a wonderful musical instrument, but these things don't throw themselves together. And even when they are put together nicely, they don't always sound fantastic. What you need is a person with the ultimate mechanical skill and musical ear to refine them and give them the voice that they have. Well, we have someone here to thank for that, and that is Brant Duddy. I like to say publicly that we shouldn't forget organ men are musicians, organ men and women. And this is a halfway venture between the player and the person who voices and regulates and sets up the instrument. They're just as much as a musician as players, and they also keep our egos in check, which is very good. And I have no more respect for such a person in that profession than Brant Duddy. He has the most incredible ear. And he is very kind and generous, and I'm so grateful for all the time I've been able to spend talking with him. And today is Brant's 91st birthday. Not only does he continue to work on this organ, he works on regulating the pipework in Atlantic City after that stuff laid dormant for decades, and he's made it sound so pretty and wonderful, and he still gets around doing all this stuff despite the fact he's one seriously old mother. You see, you know what's happening, it's I get up here thinking, I'm supposed to retire. I don't want to have to give all this up now. Maybe I can change my mind. Well, all I have to do is say something totally outrageous to make sure nobody books me again. Anyway, I think we know what to do now. We're going to honor Brant in the way we know best. Yeah, welcome to church. Happy birthday, Brant, and thank you so much for everything you do, and sincerely, many happy returns. I'm going to finish the first half with a bit of pomp and circumstance from the UK. This is one of my favourite marches of Eric Coates. I'm sure you all recognise it. This is one that you don't hear as often as you'd expect anymore, so I thought I'd play it. It is the Dam Busters March. Of course, typical Eric Coates march, it starts with a little bouncy section, and then it has the flowing cello line for the main theme, and then it repeats with the brass, and they have an obbligato and the piccolos and things. Well, we have a thing called second touch on the theatre organ, so I can push a bit harder with my left hand, and we'll get some trombones coming through there, and then I'll play the obbligato with the right hand. That's a hell of a lot of working out, so you better like it. Here we go, Dan Buster's March.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now take a 15-minute intermission. Thank you.
Okay, welcome back for the second half of our show. Before we bring out David for the second half, I wanted to remind you about our next regular concert that will be on Saturday, March 14th. And here it has the wrong date, unfortunately. It says January 28th. That's like in a couple days. So our next concert is Saturday, March 14th. It's going to be one of those two concerts during our 50th season where we feature dual consoles. So, of course, we'll have the mighty Kimball console here, and we'll also bring out the Boyd console, the original Boyd console. And, of course, when we feature dual consoles, we have to have two people to play it, right? So we have duo artists. We are so excited to present Jelani Eddington from Wisconsin and Donnie Rankin from Ohio. Two fantastic artists together in one concert for what's going to be a magnificent presentation of some great music, so be sure not to miss that concert. And then on the afternoon of Saturday, March 28th, we'll have a special added feature in addition to our regular season concerts. We're calling it Saturday at the Silence. It's going to feature John Barata and two films, a short and a long film. Information about that is in your program, and the date's correct in there. Tickets for these two events, as well as all the other events and concerts remaining in our 50th season, will be available at the door, the night of the concert, and of course online. After our concert tonight, we'll be hosting a reception up here on stage, where we'll have the opportunity to meet and greet David Gray, our featured artist, and have an opportunity to enjoy some delicious snacks and refreshments before you make your way home. And as always, thank you to all of those who donated snacks and to the volunteers that make that reception possible. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the bench, David Gray.
Thank you.
Can we just finish now? I didn't really ever think I'd attempt that on an organ. I was once forced to scratch the cello at school, in high school, as a second study, and I faked my way through the orchestral part of that piece and fell in love with it at that point, and then realized there was quite a lot of trickery on theatre organs that might enable me to try and get through the work. That, of course, is the Vltava, or the Moldau, by Biedrich Smetana, which, for those of you who don't know, pictures the river that runs through Prague. It starts with all those tributes, with those little flutes and things, which sounds lovely, but it's a shame it's so torturous for me to play. And then there's a wedding it goes through, and a hunting scene, and the quiet, obviously, and then the rapids, and finally goes through the city of Prague, out to the estuary, in a nice big cheesy Satyrus de Picardy major ending. So I forgot to mention before the interval, or the intermission, you guys call it, that I have some CDs for sale. That's my latest release on, I think, just about the largest theater organ in the world, and the home of Jasper and Marion Sanfilippo. That organ is 5 manuals, 80 ranks, and I call the CD 80 Shades of Grey. But please rest assured, the title of the disc is nothing to do with the size of the organ. Up next, the only thing I can follow such a transcription with is something rather quirky and out there. So here is a British novelty by Frederick Curzon. This piece is called Dance of an Ostracized Imp. There is a poem that goes with this. Here's an imp who was far too proud to submerge his ego as part of a crowd. So, accepting exile with nonchalance, he capered away to this quaint little dance. Here we go. Astor Piazzolla, the great Argentinian accordionist. That was Oblivion. Not so many organists have played it, but I think actually this, it really works the best of any instrument I've played it on in here, with all these wonderful ousophones, or whatever you call them, the flute celeste and things. And I'm going to not actually sit with my legs bent on the bench, because it looks like I've got these in some kind of charity shop or something and patched them up. But right before the concert, I did what you know, people like my mother are telling me not to do, is I jumped up. Oh, in fact, you know what I did? I leapt up on the stage, except this time there's a bloody big nail poking right out here and tore my pants to bits, so they're currently being held together with gaffer tape, if that excites any of you. So up next, why not some more improvisation, and to the point that I actually just wrote to my friend Mark Herman. I said, what should I play? He says, maybe some more Harry Warren from the Gold Diggers, 1933-37. So he suggested a few tunes, and I haven't tried them. I think I've played some of them before, but we'll see what happens. So here's an instant medley. We are in the money. I've got to sing a torch song, Shovel Off to Buffalo, Shadow Waltz, and All's Fair in Love and War. I have actually played that one, to be fair, if you'll pardon the pun. What key should I start in this time?
D.
Somebody say C flat. Somebody said F sharp. I'm going to have to go with it. All right. We're going to be experiencing a very quick modulation.
Thank you.
A great name that sadly departed the last 20 years, and that is John Seng. And I played the instrument he developed his great style on in Mundelein a few years back. And when I was there, I learned an arrangement of John Seng's of St. Louis Blues. He called it St. Louis Blues with a twist because it was kind of this straight-laced, camp 1960s funky little thing. I thought it was quite fun, and the Mundelein had some very particular sounds for that piece. And I thought, well, actually, this organ has just about everything in it. I can probably pull some of those sounds out of here as well. So this is, I'll say, John Seng inspired St. Louis Blues with a twist, because I may deviate and give it some twists of my own, maybe. Here we go.
Thank you.
We have one more number, actually. I thought we were at the end of the program there. My scribblings. Here's a Leonard Cohen song that you're all familiar with, I'm sure. And this is a tune that my granny would describe as being able to bring a tear to a glass eye. So, of course, this has seen many modern twists. It's about to see another one. This is my modern offering for the evening, having been written, what, in 1983 or something. So, very avant-garde. Here's Hallelujah.
Thank you.
about at the end of the program before I get on to my last party piece. There's many people I have to thank, of course, for putting this kind of a show on. But first and foremost is someone who has looked after me more than he needed to, because I came in a day early, and he really has put in the hours, as many and more than I have, and that is Carl Black. Carl does so much for this school, for this organization, and he's been at it for like 50 years as well. I didn't think he looked 50, so he must have been very young when he started, but I can't thank him enough. So please, can we just first show Carl our appreciation? DTOS for everything they have done to keep the standard of theatre organ concerts as high as it could be on this magnificent, superlative instrument. And we have so many people, of course, to thank for that. And I did already mention Brant, who I'm just filled with so much admiration for all the tonal work he does. And I'll see him in Atlantic City. I said call them my Atlantic City family, are here tonight. So I didn't see him yet. Hi, Dennis and Larry, wherever you are. Who else is there? Yeah, the entire theatre organ world. How about that? I've been playing concerts on the theatre organ for about 12 years or something, and people are wondering why I'm choosing to pull away. Very silent suddenly. This makes me very awkward. It's nothing too dramatic. It's just I have to be practical. I don't play church organs. Could you imagine me playing communion? I'd be fired in 10 minutes. I did start out as a pianist, and I think I have to be practical. You only live once, and I ain't getting any younger. Almost 30. Yeah, well. In piano terms, that's basically dead. So it's merely that I want to take a bit of a break, and for that, just to kind of figure out what I'm doing, I'm taking a break from concerts. I don't know how long for, so that's why I'm not saying that it's forever. I mean, like, put it this way, I'm insane, but I'm not an idiot. I wouldn't throw away everything I've worked for on theatre organs just because. I will still play the instruments, I'll just, it will be a lot rarer when I do appear. And I'll do so just for the fun of it, rather than touring a lot, even though I like all of the venues, of course. I think that's pretty much it. Oh, I could just go on forever about everything I've loved about my years playing theatre organ, but all I will just do is say it's been fun, it's been great, and thank you very much. Association with this instrument has enriched my musical life in ways that I couldn't have imagined, in ways that other people from different backgrounds don't have the privilege of having. So I'll always have that with me, whether or not I'm playing actually on an organ at the time. All right, so I'm going to finish up with a piece that makes the one I opened this half with look like a warm-up. And it's lots of fun. I thought I'll end with a bang. And I do like to do these big transcriptions, and big organs do this kind of thing very well. So here I'm going to try to do my best to present in its entirety Tchaikovsky's 1812 Overture. Yes, I've found a way to put almost all the parts in. Now there's one very famous bit of this piece, of course, at the end, which is the cannons. And you know, you can get a pretty good effect for cannons, like with an empty shotgun shell into a barrel or something. But I thought it may be a bit ill-advised to try and walk into a high school with a whole pile of shotguns. So we're gonna go with some organ pipes instead. And there's also a very important tool I need for this piece. It's a pencil. Because you see, there's part, two-thirds of the way through, was for 200 bars for about 2 minutes, there's nothing but a bass B-flat sustained. Well, I'm not wasting two perfectly good feet in a pedal board on that. So you'll see me stick this thing in the B-flat, the solo keyboard, and I'll leave it there until I need to pull it out again, and that way I can play some more tunes with my feet. That's the plan, and I'm sticking to it. That will go there. No more stalling. All right, I'll get on with this. Here we go, 1812 Overture. Thank you.